looking for the water, looking for the sea, searching for my trouble, but my trouble finds me. Everybody breaks, everybody.
Coming
breaks,
to you from the University of Minnesota, Rochester.
Looking for the
our town.
Streetcar or bus rapid transit? Is there a right answer, Kevin?
I think it depends. It's up to the community members themselves to make that decision, I think. But
well, we're here with Kevin Bright, Director of Energy and Sustainability from DMC-EDA, and he joins us today to tell us what we need to know about the transit alternatives under consideration by the city. So there are two different modes that are under consideration, as you mentioned, streetcar and BRT, bus rapid transit.
Yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit about maybe what the challenges and benefits of the streetcar are?
Sure. Well, first, the streetcar and the bus rapid transit, they'd fall or run on the same route, and they provide the same level of service and move the same number of people. The primary difference between them is, would they run on a rail that's embedded into the street, or would they run on tires? There's some differences in cost. The streetcar is more expensive than a bus rapid transit option. And there's some difference in how they might be adopted by the users of the community. So in other communities, other cities that have put in rail, more people ride rail typically than more people choose to ride a bus. So there's some kind of predispositions that community members might have about one technology or another.
Depending on their experience with it previously or something like
that. Sure, yep.
Right. Will it look very different? I know we've got some we have an image of the two options. Will it look very different on right here? Can you just take a look and see how people might tell the difference between the two?
Yeah, so the image on the right or lower right has the rail embedded into the roadway, but by and large they look pretty similar. A rail car may have overhead electric wires above it depending on the type of technology that's used for the rail car itself, but by and large they look pretty similar, and that's kind of the intent. Okay. Is that they provide a similar visual experience for the folks using it.
Okay, great. So this, you're asking for community feedback. What kind of questions should I be asking myself as I'm kind of filling out a survey or kind of thinking about things?
Sure. I guess we would ask folks to think about how they commute on a day-to-day basis. Do they drive a car? Do they currently use the bus? Do they walk or bike? And think about how a circulator that has termini to the west of the downtown or the southeast may impact how they currently get to work. If they had to park at one of those transit villages and then use one of these circulators, is there a particular mode they would prefer? Is there a particular path that they would prefer that this circulator takes? Perhaps their house is closer to one route or the other, or maybe they have a certain love for rail versus bus. That's the kind of feedback that we're hoping community members can provide.
So they don't need to know all the ins and outs of, you know, transportation theory and things like that, but just kind of thinking about personal preferences, personal experience with how they travel now.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Yeah.
And what are you doing to collect that community feedback?
Sure. So there's a number of things, a number of community engagement activities that are going on. There is a tent on Thursdays on First at the city, and the DMC and others have been using to help collect feedback from folks that are going to that. Will be more community meetings to solicit feedback, and there is a website called Polco that has a range of questions on it, as well as all the information about what's being asked of the community on there if you want more information on how to inform yourself on, get up to speed on what's being asked and what the options are, and get people's feedback.
Awesome. Well, I've taken the Polco survey.
Nice.
And I've also taken a look at some of the kind of live results that have come back so far, and there seems to be like a few common questions, one of them being, what is a circulator? In sort of simple terms, what is it?
Sure. So it's a fixed transit line that would run in between two nodes, and it would provide service between those two nodes 18 hours a day, 365 days a year, and provide, so during the week it's thought that you could wait there 5 minutes and a bus or rail car would show up in order to get you someplace downtown, and on the weekends about 10-minute level of service.
And a node would be sort of like a station, a place, it kind of has a loop.
Mm-hmm. Well, not quite a loop.
Okay.
So it would kind of run in a line between one station and back in the other direction. Okay. And had stations along the way.
Okay.
In between these two kind of end nodes. One is the Mayo West lot out on 2nd Street, and the other possible location is Grand Park or the Seneca Foods lot.
Okay.
For the southeast location.
Yeah. And that gets to another question that I saw a bit about too, is plans to extend it to other neighborhoods outside of sort of the downtown metro area.
Yeah, there are no plans at the moment. But it is interesting that other communities that have made it a transit line investment such as these have ended up extending them after the fact.
And another question, certainly a natural, I think, as we continue to develop in the city is how is it going to be funded?
So there's a range of funding sources. So a lot of the DMC funds that were provided to the city of Rochester and Olmsted County and the DMC project were meant to be allocated towards transportation. So actually $114 million of the DMC dollars that were provided for the project specifically need to be used for the support of a transportation system. So that's one source. City, county, and then we're also pursuing some federal dollars to help establish this transportation system in the city as well through the Small Starts program, which is a lot of cities across the United States put an application together in order to ask for funding from the federal government in order to start a transportation program because the first cost is usually too high for the city or county or others to allocate themselves or find funding sources on their own.
So after collecting all this community feedback, what is the next, phase or the next steps in kind of pursuing this?
Sure. So the next steps are, once the mode is decided, as well as the path, creating an application letter of interest and submitting that to the Federal Transit Authority. And that really says, Rochester's interested. This is our proposed transportation system that we want to create. And that gets us kind of in the pathway in order to work with the federal government on possible funding.
And what does the timeline look like?
So that takes about a year.
Okay.
So next fall, we'll have done a lot of environmental research around what are the possible environmental impacts, traffic studies and others, kind of next level of engineering analysis. Once we have this kind of conceptual idea of these are the stops, this is the route, this is the technology path, kind of the next level analysis after that, to then submit formally to the federal government to say, what do you think?
Well, thanks so much for joining us today. Tell us a little about the circulator, and thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Town is brought to you in part by the following amazing people and organizations.
Clemens Chevrolet proudly partners with award-winning KSMQ Public Television. Clemens Chevrolet in Rochester. Clemens' clear value promise is to make buying a car fast, fair, and simple. The Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota.
And the members of KSMQ Public Television. Thank you.
Be sure to stick around. We've got more great stories coming up on Our Town. We check out one of the doggiest days of summer with Dogs Downtown, and we talk about the local electoral process with ranked choice voting. But up first, we dress to impress with the Fashion Forward Sisters in this week's Our Culture segment.
Hi, I'm Sarah.
I'm April.
I'm Megan.
And we are Sistique Boutique.
So, Sistique Boutique was founded in November of 2017. Megan and Sarah and I are sister-in-laws, and so we spend a lot of time together, and we just kind of put our brains together, and we wanted to kind of start our own business, and that's where Sistique Boutique came from, hence the name Sistique. I know it's hard to believe, but we're getting back to school time, and you know, a lot of people think about like school supplies, but I know what kids are thinking. What are they gonna wear? So here we are. We're gonna talk about some fall fashion and back to school things that can be worn. We range from like junior high all the way up to, there's really no age limit in our clothes, which is really exciting about our entire line. So Abby's modeling a hoodie that we have, some jean shorts and some double buckle sandals. That's all really in style right now. But the hoodie she has on is a double hooded, which is really in style, the two hoods and the buffalo plaid. So the black and red checker plaid is really in style. It's got plaid accent on the shoulder, the elbows. And then there's thumb holes, which I know all kids love the thumb holes, and that also has plaid on them as well. And next we have Sarah modeling a full outfit all the way from head to toe. Her jeans.
They are distressed. Yeah. They're mom jeans or teen jeans. You don't have any buttons.
Yeah.
So if you're sitting at the desk, they won't hurt.
Into the shirt, we have a basic dolman shirt. A dolman sleeve just means that it's a little bit looser. The three-quarter sleeves, there's ruching on the sides, which is a really slimming thing. This one's gonna look really cute, but you're gonna be in style and cute and comfortable during the day.
All right, next up we have Megan. She's featuring our most popular glitter sandals. They have the double buckle and the nice glitter style that's really in trend right now. It's a rose gold color. And then followed up by a beautiful eggplant waffle top. It's got a thick knitting to it, oversized fit, very comfortable, casual.
This is April. And she has on taupe boots with some nice buckles.
And then she has the nice blue-ish charcoal colored cross top with the nice buttons up top and the neckline. Kind of loose fit across the shoulders so it's not so tight. Loose neckline so you stay comfortable. Open in the front.
And next we have Mary. She is modeling a full outfit head to toe. She is modeling an outfit that could easily be worn by a student, a teacher, a staff member, anyone going back to school, or just anyone in general. She has on the crisscross gladiator sandals. They have a zipper on the back, so easily slide on and off, super comfy to wear. You could dress those up or down easily. She has on black moto jeggings. The moto jeggings are super popular right now too. They have the moto detail on each leg, which is just some pleated lines in each leg. And they also have the elastic waistband, which is easily can be taken on and off, super comfy. And most importantly, the shirt, which is a combination of stripes and a beautiful plum color top. And we've got elbow patching on each elbow, which is just a nice fun detail that kind of dresses the shirt up, gives it a little more character. All right, so just a quick recap. So some of the really popular things for this fall are gonna be the things we covered: distressed jeans, I know minimal distressing or destroyed jeans, the waffle knit with the sweaters, the stripes, and the really big one is the plaid. So plaid is always really in, especially in the fall leading up to Christmas. So the plaids and all of those good things.
You can shop all these looks at Sistique.com.
And we ship for free.
Always.
For more information about this story and other Our Town features, connect with us on Facebook, Twitter at KSMQ hashtag Our Town, or ksmq.org/ourtown.
Sometimes it's hard to breathe, all these thoughts are shouting me, try to bring me to my knees, and it's overwhelming, darkness echoes all around, feels like everything is crashing down, still I know where my hope is found.
Popeye and olive oil, Betty Boop, Mighty Mouse. If these were your Saturday morning companions of childhood, you can relive their comical capers at the Grey Duck Theater on Saturday, August 31st at 9 a.m. This time around, you can sip your favorite caffeinated beverage while you get your weekend off to a joyful start. You can come and go as you please, and there's no need for a ticket. Complete information at Grey Duck Theater's Facebook page. And Rochester has a plethora of live music scenes, and the list just keeps on growing. Grand Oak Opry hosts intimate house concerts, and they've teamed up with Rochester resident The Jive Mill and Root River Jam to bring Eric Piskinen to town on Saturday, August 31st. Eric specializes in working men's blues, and there's no tickets per se, but attendees are asked to make a $10 donation, all of which go to the performing artist. Again, Facebook has all the details. Just search Grand Oak Opry to learn more. And as Kevin mentioned, the City of Rochester and Destination Medical Center are seeking community feedback on the proposed transit circulator route and mode, either bus rapid transit or modern streetcar like we talked about. And they'll have a booth at Thursday's downtown to collect your opinion, and you can share your thoughts through the city's online survey tool, PALCO. There are 5 specific questions to help guide them as they look to provide high quality and reliable downtown public transportation. Check out rochestermn.gov for the details. And the Rochester Area Foundation announced the recipients of their We Give 365 grants for July. $1,000 awards went to Gateway Rochester, Hiawatha Homes, Jeremiah Program Rochester, and Samaritan Bethany Foundation. We Give 365 is a dollar-a-day collaborative giving program that lets members pool their money to make a positive impact in our community. To learn more, visit rochesteraria.org. And it's back to school. As we look forward to school starting, the United Way of Olmsted is once again offering their Running Start for School to help area students. Backpacks outfitted with school supplies are made available to area students to make sure kids reach their full potential for learning. To find out if your student is eligible for a free backpack and supplies, contact your child's school. More information can be found at uwolmsted.org. And man's best friend had a heyday on the streets of downtown. Let's find out more from Danielle Teal in this week's Walkabout segment.
This is Danielle Teal with Our Town Walkabout. We're at Dogs Downtown at the Peace Plaza, where it's bringing dog lovers together. There are pugs, there are St. Bernards, there are poodles, German Shepherds, you name it, they're here. Hi, Millie.
Yes.
Do you like the wire?
She's loving it.
And does your voice change when you're talking to her, too?
It does.
What is this, a poodle?
She's a golden doodle.
A golden doodle. I've heard of them.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness.
Hi, Maggie. Hi. How are you?
She loves everybody and everything. So.
And even other dogs.
Oh, yes.
She plays well.
Oh, yes.
All right.
Hi, Boo-Boo. Hi, Boo-Boo. You are cute. Cute little doggy.
We just got him 3 days ago.
3 days ago.
Yeah.
Does Boo Boo do any tricks yet?
He can roll.
He can roll?
For us, we just wanted to gain some experience on, good dog owner etiquette.
Sure.
And what to do in the beginning. I've already met a lot of Pomeranian owners that have told me
cool.
good advice.
Okay.
So my son has wanted a dog for well over a year. This exact kind and color.
Would you look at that? There's dogs everywhere. What is the one thing that you enjoy most about this event?
Seeing all the different kinds of dogs and seeing how Wally does with different kinds of dogs.
And how is he doing?
She is.
Oh, she. That's the one thing, you don't know the gender until they tell you.
Yeah, she's curious and excited.
Okay.
So she'll be like, oh, I want to check that one out. Oh, pick me up again.
Oh, very funny.
Yeah.
Hi.
And we were lucky because we're just babysitting the dog for the weekend.
Oh.
But new dog might be in the future.
Oh,
no, we're not.
Do you want a dog now?
Yes.
You do want a dog.
Oh, no, I always wanted a dog.
You've always wanted a dog. Mm-hmm. What a wonderful event to bring dog lovers together. This is Danielle Teal with Our Town Walkabout.
Everybody wants the crown. Everybody wants the crown. When it's upside down, point it to the ground. Everybody,
if you stopped by the Olmsted County Fair last month, you may have been asked to cast a ballot ranking your favorite fried delicacy. The voting activity was organized by Ranked Choice Voting Rochester, and organizer Vangie Castro joins us today to talk about electoral reform ahead of a big election year and what ranked choice voting might mean for the democratic process in our city. Welcome to Our Town, Vangie.
Oh, thanks for having me, Nicole.
So let's just jump right in. What are some of the key issues that you've identified with just the voting process in the city?
Well, the reason I kind of started working on this campaign is because of the primaries that we had last year. We had two re-elections in Ward 1 and Ward 5, and it can get really costly for the city. So that's one of the reasons. Also, that the diversity of candidates that we have. If you kind of look at a lot of our leadership, they seem a little similar in their backgrounds and also in their ethnicities. And it's really great to, if we could start having folks represent the demographics of our city in leadership and city government.
So some of the things that you've also identified in previous conversations have been things like low voter turnout. How is ranked choice voting addressing something like low voter turnout?
Well, in the primaries, usually there's only about a 16% to 22% voter turnout, depending on the election year. If it's a presidential year, more people will come out for the primaries. But in a non-election year, you have like 16% of registered voters who decide who you're going to vote for in the general election. And I think for folks who can't get to the primaries, it doesn't really give them the choice of a full breadth of the candidates that they really wanted to vote for before they were eliminated at the primaries. And so I think what ranked choice voting does is help solve the problem of allowing to have more of a broader base of candidates that folks can feel more engaged and kind of follow them through the whole election cycle until November.
So give us a quick primer. So if I'm looking at a ballot, what's that gonna look like if it has ranked choice voting?
So it would kind of be like you have your first choice, second choice, third, fourth or fifth choice, and it would just have the names of the candidates, A, B, or C, and then you would get to rank them by preference. if it's B, your first choice, and A would be your second, and C would be your third, then that would be kind of how the ballot would look. And then we would go towards tallying. So what happens is that this, what it does is kind of create more of a more efficient election. So instead of having the primary and the general election, we would just combine the two and then kind of have this instant runoff, which we would take care of the expensive recounts that we would have.
So there won't be any primaries, is what you're saying?
For the city, for the mayor and the city council. But there would be primaries for the state and for the national
elections. And we have had a couple of recounts. Can you remind us about the recount
that
just happened
recently? Yeah, so we had in the 2018 primaries in Ward 1 and Ward 5, we had recounts there. And also in the general election, we had a recount in Ward 5.
So some people might say that ranked choice voting is a little complicated. Is it too complicated to adopt at the city level?
You know, if you can rank your favorite flavors of candy or ice cream, I think you can rank on your ballot of who your favorite candidates are. But I think what our current politics have created is this this polarization of like that you only need to like one over the other. And that's really not how we live our life.
There's more of a spectrum of how we think about different candidates and our choices.
Especially when it comes to city government, when it comes to like what's going on in our day-to-day lives, we have a lot of different issues that we care about. And I think it's great to know that there are candidates who actually support some of those issues that you also support. And instead of thinking like, well, this is just a one-issue candidate, they do kind of care about what I care about, so I guess I'll vote for them. Kind of that idea of the better of two evils candidate. And I always just really kind of want to get away from that polarization and lessen that and kind of bring us back to like civil discourse and talking more about issues instead of, you know, candidates' personalities.
So you mentioned earlier that ranked choice voting, in your opinion, makes it so that there's more diverse candidates, mm-hmm. and also it increases representation and even diverse voter turnout. How does it do that?
So what happens is the idea of like, let's just say kind of a non-conventional or third party candidate, right? Some folks think that if they give their vote to that third party candidate, it creates a spoiler system. Or if they don't get past the primary, then folks become disinterested in the political process. And so they might not vote in the November election because their candidate didn't move forward. But if you have ranked choice voting and all the candidates get to move forward, then you have more folks who are involved in the political process. Also, you have candidates who will be that would feel compelled to have to reach beyond their base because what they're seeking is second and third choice votes. So I might not be your first choice, but maybe if we talk and discuss about some of the issues that you care about, maybe I'll become your second choice or even your third choice, and that might help in helping me win in November, if I ran for a political office.
And then in terms of, you know, maybe the one issue kind of mm-hmm. candidate, or even just some of the negativity that kind of comes up around campaigns and things like that, how does ranked choice voting, how does it address that at all?
Well, what happens is that you have to reach beyond your base. So folks that usually never talk to people beyond their base now have to like have conversations. And so instead of kind of that negative campaigning where people talk about like, well, this candidate is going to do all these awful things. Well, what if those awful things were things that you really kind of cared about? So now we just have to kind of actually have conversations with voters about like, okay, well, what are these things that you really do care about? So now we can focus on that. And so I think for me, that makes us get back to the nitty-gritty of governance versus just campaigning.
So obviously you're a true believer in ranked choice voting.
Yeah, for sure.
What are some of the biggest critiques though on the other side about it?
Well, you mentioned earlier the fact that it's complicated, and I don't think it's complicated. I think a lot of folks, once we educate them about it, and actually what, like you mentioned about voting, actually looking at a ballot and doing the ranked choice voting yourself, they like it. And it's easy, and I think if we just implemented it here in Rochester. They already do it in Minneapolis and St. Paul, and they're going to be implementing it in St. Louis Park. It's already been done, so there's a lot of data behind showing how successful it's been.
So what are the next steps for the possibility of adopting it here in Rochester?
Well, we're talking to the city council members of hoping to get it unanimously passed through the city council and getting the charter change. If that doesn't happen, then we'll most likely have it on the 2020 ballot as a referendum.
So a lot of the conversation obviously is around local elections and that the electoral reform at that level, but does ranked choice voting have any bearing on how we might think about presidential or nationwide elections?
Well, if you kind of look at the primary elections and folks that run in the primaries in presidential elections, you get a really crowded field. So what that does is help kind of willow that down, but also you start to feel like you can support more than one candidate. And then kind of, instead of having like someone winning and moving forward with 16%, you can have someone that has more of a broader base than having someone move forward that's 51% supported by voters.
So as an organization, Ranked Choice Voting Rochester, are you connected to Fair Vote Minnesota?
Yeah, so Fair Vote is our larger organization, and we're the local organization that's working on this.
And so that movement is just statewide around
ranked
choice
voting?
Yeah,
so it's a statewide movement, and there's also national organizations working on ranked choice voting.
And so how can the community learn more? What are you going to continue to be doing in the community in the months that are ahead?
So we've been in tons of different events, tabling and helping folks understand more about ranked choice voting. We've been at the farmers market. You can also find us at our website at Ranked Choice Voting, rcvrochester.org. You can find us on Facebook and like us, and we're also on Instagram. But call us, find us on our, go to our website, learn more about us, and if you want to have a one-on-one and sit down, we're more than happy to do that.
Great, thanks so much for joining us today, Vangie.
Oh, great, thanks for having me.
And thank you for joining us today. We've talked a lot about voting and getting your feedback, so certainly be sure to remember from the top of the show to put your feedback in for the transit circulator. And we will see you next time from the University of Minnesota Rochester on Our Town, the show about Rochester.
Sometimes I've been looking for the answer, don't help me find the cure to my cancer, 'cause I've been there before. Everybody breaks.